All right, thanks, man.
You can never know.
Man, how's Texas treating you?
It's good. It's good. It's been windy. It's been hot. It's been really hot in the race car.
I gotta ask, you know, how's the car feel today? For today.
I haven't reached over and touched it yet, so I wouldn't know. I think we're really good. I can't say that we're the quickest car when it comes to busting off a lap, but I think we'll be pretty good consistency-wise over the run, so that's what I'm telling myself in my head.
Okay, yeah, there you go. You got a lot of fans out here. They've been waiting for hours for you. It's unbelievable. I gotta ask you, I was on my way out here, and they said that I was going to interview you again, and I was thinking of not just the typical questions. I'm getting good at the follow-up questions, so I have to ask you, if you could talk about NASCAR in just five different words, what would those five words be to explain NASCAR?
Five different words to explain it.
Yeah.
See, I'm too analytical for a question like that.
No, you're not. That's why I
first of all, the fans. Very good of all, the horsepower. I'm trying to narrow it down. That was kind of the horsepower direction I was going for, because you can't have Speedway on horsepower. Going. Great racing, passing, something like that. Come on. Winning.
How about food?
I was going to go bikinis, but if you want to go food.
Beer, bikinis.
Whatever you're into. I don't drink, so I don't do the beer. But I do avoid you all the way home.
No, I fly. I gotta ask, one of your fans right back over here asked me where she asked me if you're gonna re-sign your contract with Tony.
Yeah, that's enough to disappoint anybody, yes.
Okay, I got a question too. I'm going to be interviewing Tony later on today.
Okay.
What would be an awesome question that I can ask Tony that he could, oh my God, where'd that just come from?
I know. And he's going to look at you like, what?
I don't want him to hit me.
He's not here, is he? Ask him how long it takes for him to change instead of windshield wipers. I'll tell you the story because he's going to hear it. I want to see if he tells the same thing. One of my crew guys, my interior guy, is really good friends with him, as I am. But for whatever reason, Tony's girlfriend sends a picture through the windshield of Tony in his face trying to change windshield wipers. I don't know if it was at a gas station or wherever it was. And she had said that on the bottom of it, it's taking him forever. You can see it on his face, he was really frustrated. So he showed this to me. We were sitting in a race car doing a test or something. So I think we're down at Burlington test, tire test. And I had texted later that night and asked him how long it took for him to do it. And I can't actually respond to what he said. Just ask you about changing windshield wipers.
You have to share the story. I asked you this before, and you were telling the story that Tony actually lived with you for a little while.
Who did?
Tony. Stuart? Yeah. No. Or he stayed with you for a little while or something like that. How here he was in a minute. No? Okay.
He lived with Harvick.
Yeah. Oh, that's what it was. Okay, you're right. It was Harvick. And he's like, oh my God, that guy is here.
My hair is falling out too. We look a lot the same, you know.
So one thing that I could not believe, I asked a question earlier, and this gentleman over here, I couldn't believe it. I know I've asked you this every time I interview you, but I couldn't believe how many fans American Pickers actually have. And how many fans watched you on the show? Can you tell them exactly how it all started and why you ended up on the show?
If anybody has seen our book, Pet Road Pets, the second lineup, the lady that did the photography for that is a close friend of ours, and she's also a close friend of Mike Wolf, who's the co-host on American Pickers. And I really love old stuff. I mean, the older it is, the more rusty it is, the better it is. And, anything. In fact, I just, while I was down there, I bought it on Oliver Granger, for $300 off Craigslist back home. So I like stuff like that. So she put me in touch with him, and we put it together where we could film the show, and just had some fun with it. It was probably 18 minutes of TV time. We spent 8 hours doing it. We played foosball, had lunch at the house, and just hung out, exchanged stories and things like that. But he had told me that they had, I think, like 2 million viewers per episode, whatever it was, their entire first season. That was what they set for. And then they opened up the second season at 4 million viewers. And that wasn't because it was my episode, but they had grown so much. So I get it all the time. People ask me if I hung the sign up yet. And it's like, man, the sign was hung before you ever saw the show.
Now, I just want to make sure that I told these guys the right amount of money. You paid $500 for
the sign. No, come on.
No?
I paid $500 for it, and I didn't realize until I watched the episode after my episode that they actually only paid like $300 for it. So I got cooked on my own episode.
But tell them what happened afterwards about the fire suit.
Oh, I get
a nice guy.
Yeah, I was a nice guy, gave him a fire suit, and then I realized I paid $200 more than I should have for the sign.
And the fire suit
was
how much?
It was at least a $1,500 fire suit, $2,000 fire suit minimum. And then he had the audacity to send me a picture of it with him in it afterwards, like it wasn't in my face. And the thing was, he didn't know he was rubbing it in my face.
I gotta ask you, traveling with your family, do you ever have one of those days you get out of the car and your wife is watching you and she just starts yelling at you after you get off? Just because,
Who knows?
I know she's a huge supporter of you and stuff like that, but does she ever say, why are you thinking?
Occasionally she knows, Things like this occasionally have a short neck, yesterday was a good example of that. I didn't want to go into it. But I got back and she just said something wrong. And I'm like, I kind of said something back and it deteriorated from there. And finally, after we all settled down, I said, my day sucked. How was yours? And she goes, I'm sorry, I didn't ask. I said, that's all I wanted to hear. But we have our moments. We're a married couple.
Oh, no, I think that's cool.
If you don't have any moments, then you shouldn't be married, because you really don't care.
It's what makes you stronger, right?
And I married it. I should have thought about this at one point. My wife has like a criminal justice degree or something along those lines. And she likes the judicial system. And it's really a hell of a time trying to win an argument with that.
I gotta ask you.
And being an engineer, I usually got most of the answers, but
you don't.
Well, I do. That's the thing. And then when I get her, when I'm right, I'm even more wrong.
you're a college graduate. Does that help you communicate with your team more? That you went to college and you have a engineering degree. Does that help you communicate with your team a little bit better?
Well, yes, it does. But any engineers out there, if you are, it's okay to raise your hand. An engineer gets an answer, and for every answer he creates two additional questions, which is, how did that happen, and what can we do to make it better? So, yes, it does help. It helps from my standpoint to have that same language as the guys, but I'm just like them. When we make a change and it works, we want to know why it worked and what can we do to make it better. When we have a change that didn't work, we want to know why it didn't work and what can we do to make it better. So, those things are just how an engineering mind works, I guess you could say.
I you guys have a crazy schedule. I mean, you're at the racetrack, then you're home, and what's the one thing that you like to do when you do have a little bit of alone time? You're away from your wife, you're away from the family, you're away from the race shop, you're away from Tony. What do you like to do?
I like old cars, I like fishing, I like hunting.
Did you hear?
All those things kind of put together. I really just enjoy the outdoors. I got a hobby farm, got some chickens and some bulls, old tractors, those type of things. So that's pretty much it. It takes up three of my 5 days each week.
If you weren't driving a car right now What would you
not right now.
Well, there we go. There's the technical side of it. What would you be doing?
If I wasn't a race car driver?
Yeah. Would you be
really interested? I enjoyed motorsports, without a doubt. And it would all depend on as to why I wasn't driving a car. If I couldn't drive a car, it would change, you know, but I would love to be involved in motorsports in some way, but I also enjoy the outdoors, you know, hunting, fishing, those types of things, so.
What about when you have one of those days, and,
why are you talking all negative?
No, are you about positive? That's the thing, I want to know about what you're doing.
You want to know how I cope with
what,
it.
What
like
inspires
your
you? No, your wife gave me the questions to ask. What inspires you, or who inspires you? When you were growing up, were you a NASCAR fan? Did you used to watch TV, and did you used to say, I want to be like that?
I base a lot of my life off of Dukes of Hazzard. Didn't expect that answer, did you?
No,
I do.
So do you have a time?
I sat down with my daughters in Brooklyn. We sit down and watch Dukes of Hazzard CMT twice a night. We usually at least catch one episode. And I like Dukes of Hazzard. It's funny because I don't know if anybody can kick out of this, but I never realized until after watching the episode the third or fourth time, multiple years in a row, that they always wore the same clothes. No matter what, Daisy wore the same shorts, Little Luke wore the same shirts, Uncle Jesse had the same red hat and the same overalls.
Well, I don't know about you, but I definitely like the shorts. I mean, she can wear those every episode.
I never saw the shorts, honestly. I always admired Dale Earnhardt and Richard Petty. Richard Petty is a great ambassador of sport as far as how he treats the fans, and obviously being a champion and a race car driver all at the same time, it's tough to manage all those things when you're the public pressure is put on you, but Dale Earnhardt needed to beat the competition before he ever got to the racetrack. Those guys knew he was going to be in victory lane. Whether he was or not, you know, the next day, it wasn't their point. He had to beat. When you can mentally beat the competition, that says that you're the man. My dad is and always has been a big mentor to me just because he's taught me a lot of things. Right from wrong, he always told me, just don't do what I do and you'll be fine. And no kidding aside, he's made me who I am. Like, I'm all the same way. So I got a small family, but I spent a lot of time with my parents and my sister, and I think that's made a big difference. So to me, they were my picker for a very long time. Getting the race car to race night, my sister keeping the car clean, my mom taking lifetimes and taking burgers for us to eat, my dad and I working on a race car. So that's my backbone.
Well, Ryan, they're saying time's up. I just want to wish you luck today. I know you're going to be outstanding. Let's give him a big round of applause.
I brought an ice cold Coca-Cola. It was ice cold. Anybody want an ice cold Coca-Cola? I'm sorry, but thank you.
Enjoy. Ryan, let's give him a big round of applause.